Top of the morning. Good. We got Cindy was being creative. Okay. I'm going to start the meeting since we're going, and we have a special guest speaker today, Sarah Goldman Foster, who has come all the way from the next desk over. So she will start our meeting with an announcement.
Good morning. Salutations, everyone. How are we doing? So Rick and I have some exciting news we'd like to share with you. We are issuing a save the date, and no, we're not getting married. The save the date is for a QI Navigator training we are developing. November 16th is the day. Mark it on your calendar right now. And we will be hosting an all-day training, not actually open to just QI Navs, pretty much open to anyone who wishes to learn, who needs a sugar refresh, who needs any sort of tech training. You guys are all welcome, but the intended audience, I should say, is for QI Navs. You may or may not know that Rick and I have been, with the help of Lilania and Denver's Early Childhood Council, working on a new QI Nav credential, and we met with OEC yesterday to combine our efforts. We will be delivering online training modules, assessments, certificates, the whole shebang. I think this is something that has been long needed, and we're really excited to work on it. So over the next few months, you will be getting a lot of communications from us. So bear with us. Please respond in a timely manner if we're asking you for something. Hint, hint, there will be a survey going out next week. So I think I covered the basics.
Where?
Community First Foundation. Yeah.
And this is in conjunction with
November 16th.
The TA Day and the ECLA Membership Day. So.
Yeah, so it's a Wednesday. November 16th is a Wednesday, and we do understand that it's right before Thanksgiving. On the 17th will be, you know, ECLA's membership meeting, and then the 18th is the State TA Day. So we tacked it on because we figured people will already be coming into town. So if it's possible for you guys to tack on just an extra day, we will be sending out, you know, hotel information and things like that at a later date. But for now, please mark November 16th on your calendars. And we look forward to seeing as many of you there as possible. Thank you.
Very good.
And have a great weekend. All right, see you guys.
Are there any questions on that?
Rick, can you repeat where it's going to be?
Community First Foundation.
Community First Foundation. And we will be sending the like an announcement shortly, and then we will be sending lots of reminders. We just created a beginning of a communications plan yesterday on how often. Yes, it's in Denver.
Yeah.
You're welcome, Cindy. Any other questions? Oh, the date again is November 16th. A Community First Foundation, November 16th is a Wednesday. Any other questions?
The time?
What is the time?
Oh, well, we haven't narrowed down the time, but since it's going to be an all-day training, I have a feeling the time will probably be like 9 to 3 or 9 to 4.
That's not,
ridiculously early. Yeah.
Yeah, does that sound, does 9 o'clock sound like a good time for you guys? We can always start what time I get here at 6:45.
No, thank you.
9 is perfect.
Yeah.
Okay. So a question that's come up before is like, what kind of tickets do we have? This is a report that I generated. Since January 1st, we've had 2,434 tickets, and about 1/8 is on applications and MOUs, general trigger questions an eighth, other questions that aren't categorized as an eighth, spending is about an eighth, and the Easy Connect portal, but then we get down to requisitions and transfers, coaching, and training. So this just gives you a general idea of the tickets that come in to the Sugar Help Desk. So I would like anybody that has specific questions to either type them in the chat box or unmute yourself and list your question. What do you think of the question if they don't?
A sugar question?
A sugar question. I don't see any questions.
Was it last week that you guys covered how to resend an MOU?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Let me go back to last week so we can see what was there while you're thinking of any questions.
I have a question. If you cannot see the requisition, either coaching hours or the QI dollars for a site that has already signed an MOU, is that something that we can fix, or is that a ticket that we need to send to you?
Great question, because we've had that that happen probably about three times in the last week. We need a ticket. Essentially what happens is when the provider makes an application through the Easy Connect portal, it generates the it's supposed to generate the requisition for both the coaching and for the materials, but that connection doesn't always work, and so we have to go back, and actually we fake it. We go back into the application in Easy Connect, sort of change one field and then come back. So I don't think you guys can do that because there's so many things we have to reset in order to do that. So I'm going to write that here is when application requisitions.
So then my next question is, do you want one ticket with links for every provider, or do you want a ticket for each one of those individual providers?
So if you're having a lot, you can send one ticket with all of them. But
okay.
Do include the links, the application link, because that speeds it up a lot.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Great question. Other questions? So I'm going to go into last week's and see. Whoops, I missed it. Recorded webinars and trainings, and then Friday support calls. We had the common troubleshooting tips of edit, save. Actually, we had a ticket come in this morning that we had a wrong email for a QI navigator. She went to the requisition and saw that it was a different email. So essentially what I did is I just went into edit and save, and it updated the correct one. So sometimes edit save solves problems that it's a really easy. And we went through when to cancel and resend an MOU, and Sarah had the vendor updates. We talked quite a bit about communications, and The reports, actually Sharon and I met on Wednesday to start the report process. And we're going to have interesting sort of labels in front of the reports. So there'll be a, like a pound sign will be a standard report that people will use. And then an exclamation is like a required report. So, but more of that to come. We went through and created about 15, well, just a list of 15 reports or so that we think people will use, and we're going to be trying to really narrow down the list of reports that are there. Oh, this is Tiffany, I love your question. It's, can we troubleshoot one of my MOU's primary contact not uniquely found for this organization? I love that question. So I'm so excited about answering a question. Oh, yay, and Teresa got in. So things are looking up. Okay, so Tiffany, can you send the application link or you can help me get in. So, are you there, Tiffany? Oh, she's working on it. Okay, so we have these long pauses. It's like, I wish I could sing or something like that. So any other questions while we're waiting for Tiffany's link? Oh, here we go. I see the link coming. And again, just so you know, I absolutely love links when you put them in your tickets, and again, just copy what's up here in the browser and paste it in your ticket. So because that sometimes I get the wrong application or the wrong provider, and this really avoids a lot of problems. Okay, so what Tiffany is saying is she got this message from Sugar. You'll see when you have the list, this MOU error, see status details, and here's the message, primary contact not uniquely found for this organization. So what we're saying, okay, I know that there's a primary contact, and here's the organization up here. So what we need to do is we'll click, I'm going to right click on this and open it in a new tab, so we'll still have the application open. Okay, and so when you right-click and go, you go to the next one. And Sarita is here. I'm going to go back because I forget. Primary contact, not uniquely found. So if we look down here under primary contact, yep, there's no primary contact, so there's no email we can send this to. So Tiffany, can you either unmute yourself or tell me who the primary contact is for this account? I'm guessing it's the same name, Sarita Lewis, but I'll let you let me know. Sarita Lewis, all right. Okay, so what we need to do, hopefully she has a contact record, but if not, we'll create one. So in the primary contact, I'm going to type Sarita. So she does have a contact. And one of the things, just to let you know, if you see the name twice or three times, or sometimes you'll see them 15 times, that same name, that will create major problems. So we have to merge records at that time, and you'll need our help because merging records can be, we can merge them the wrong way and it will create problems. So if you see the name more than once here, then create a ticket. But we have her name only once, so we're okay. And you notice that the primary contact email is still blank. You don't fill that in. What happens is that when you hit save, it goes through and updates the record. So I'm going to hit save. And her email goes there. So what when you're sending an MOU, it definitely has to have an email under primary contact, or else it wouldn't know where to save it. So Tiffany, is it okay if I go ahead and send this MOU? Yep, okay. So under, after we've done that change, I'm going to click Actions and then Send MOU, and we'll all, can somebody do a drum roll or a, I don't know how you do a drum roll in the text box, but we want to, we're hoping that this will work when we hit save, especially since it's live. Okay, so it's saving, drum roll, fingers crossed. Oh, Philip, he has a, still saving. It's a drum roll, oh, okay. Oh, look, Phil's drum roll worked. Look, hooray, Rick just sent the MOU. So that's how you solve that problem. So again, what Tiffany saw in here, then there was an error, essentially, under the MOU status. And then in the message from Sugar, it told us what the problem was, that there was a primary contact not found. So cool. We fixed that. Tiffany, do you have any other questions? And Nicole, maybe it was your fingers being crossed rather than Phil's drum roll that made it work. But whichever one of it worked, I appreciate it. Well, somebody else is coming up with a question. Either again, unmute. I want to see Phil's drum roll. Well, that's a long one. Wow, it just goes on and on. But I think it did take about 52 seconds for the save to work. So thank you, Phil, for that drum roll. Aw, he says, I do what I can for people I like. Well, we like you too. So do you have... Yes, we can count on Phil for a bit of humor. And for Lisa to mentioning that Phil has humor. Does anybody have any other questions? And we have a couple of people from OEC. Any announcements for us?
This is Phil. I don't have anything from my end.
Oh, darn it, Phil. I was counting on you.
I know. I'm sorry.
Okay. Okay, Jose is great. He's filling in some time. He said it's more about merging records. So the biggest problem that we have, well, not the biggest problem, what the most often when we're merging records is when we have two contacts with the same name. And a lot of people think that, like, if you have different roles, let's say you're a director of a daycare center and a part-time coach, that you should have two different contact records. That's not true. You need to only have one contact record, and then on each of the organizations you're part of, you know, you can put in your role as coach or director, but it really creates problems when there's more than one contact, I mean, one person is more than one record. Because, for example, when it's sending the MOU, it gets confused, like, what role is this person, when are they sending? So we definitely need one contact. Yes, Kristen yesterday was the one that she had some problems on hers, and it was because she had two different records for her, and we merged it. Yes, we merged hers yesterday. But part of the problem with merging is that you'll have different phone numbers, different addresses, and we really don't know what's right. So a lot of times we might need you on the phone when we're merging records. So you can say, okay, that's the right email, that's the right address. Or if we can't get you on the phone, we'll have you correct the record after it's been merged. And you know, there could be like, in some cases, like 50 coaching calls on one record, there could be spending on another record, and so it does merge the number of records, but it does confuse the program when you have two contact records. Did that answer your question, Jose? Yep, okay. Another thing actually sort of related to that is in some accounts, the names are so similar. So that is another reason why I like for you to, like if I put in Kinder, let me put in Kinder, for example. There are lots and lots of Kinder Care, Kinder something, Kinder others. So again, what I ask, if you want us to work on KinderCare Learning Centers LLC, definitely include the URL, copy that, and put it into your ticket. I have a question about entering coaching details. Can I enter details for something that occurred 2 months ago, or for any details that may have gotten overlooked but want to capture, even if it was before July? Cindy, I personally would say yes. If you've already reported stuff, then you might have to, whoever you sent your reports to, you might have to update them. But one of the things that I've been doing when I've been out on calls, we've had to make corrections because, for example, the end of year report, you know, that you do, or an end of quarter report, might not match Sugar. And so you might have to make updates. Does anybody else have any comments about that question, about putting in old coaching or old spending or something like that?
Rick, I think what you said makes sense. I also think it may depend on what it is you're actually doing as to whether it's something that would affect your report to a funder. So you may or may not need to do that. Is it something for yourself? Is it something that does impact that data?
Lisa, did that capture what you were saying, or did you want to clarify it a little more?
That works for me.
Okay, and it looks like it worked for Cindy. Teresa mentioned that she would put the newest stuff in first. When you're sort of back updating stuff. Okay. Okay, Nicole is saying, if we have an active MOU signed by a director that retires before the end of the agreement, do we need to do a new agreement with the new director to continue working with the center? Perhaps an amendment? What would be the best approach? That's a really good question. I'm going to type it down, and I will depend on the more experienced sort of legal type people in the audience. Perhaps even somebody from the OEC, since it's often related to funding streams. What would be the recommendation that you all would have in this situation for a director that retires and is a signatory on an MOU.
So Rick, this is Lisa. I would consider that that agreement is not with that individual, but with that organization, and they signed it on behalf of the organization. So I, in most circumstances, would not have another MOU signature. That would be the same as a director of a council changing mid-year with any of our grants and things. We don't have to go back because that's an agreement with our agency, and that person is just the signatory on behalf of the agency. But I'm curious what other people think.
Me too. I like that answer. That's how I would approach it, is that, you know, if I'm signing something for ECLA as the director of data and evaluation, you know, I assume that that's my role rather, you know, I'm signing it as the role rather than as the person, Rick. But I would love to hear other people on the call. Sandra says it makes sense to her. I know we still have a couple of people on the from OEC on the call. Does it make sense to you as well? I mean, you certainly can get back to us, but just in general, if there's a one of you would like to chime in. Agree. Just because a CEO resigns, it doesn't nullify any previous established contractual obligations. Right, and if the question is that the question if an MOU. Okay, why don't you say that's how you answered it, Phil? I'm going to put Phil's opinion. So now, but we'll double check. Great question, Nicole. Do you think that we answered it basically? And if it changes, well, you know, certainly we can bring it up on the next call, Phil, or you know, you can send me an announcement. You can put it in the monthly announcements that you guys do as well, if it should change. Okie dokie. Is that how you spell okie dokie? O-K-I-E-D-O-K-I-E. I think so. That's how I would spell it. Yeah. So you pass the test. That's how I spell it. Yep. Other questions? Yes, Sandra. It sounds good. I know that, actually we could, let me highlight it. And if anybody, you know, happens to have a law degree, just in case. Okay, Teresa, I have a question. Monthly reports for OEC, are we to send those results out to OEC? Or they're pulling them themselves. OEC is, as far as I know, they're pulling the reports themselves. So for the reports that are in Sugar, the OEC will pull the reports themselves. They may ask you for clarification. Did I get that right? Whoever maybe knows more than I do? Because my understanding, they do it for they run the report for the whole, you know, all councils. Teresa, oh, yay, best answer of the day.
This is Phil. We were actually talking about that the other day, and I think the QRIS specialists have more knowledge on this than I do, but my understanding is that between these monthly ECC calls and the sugar reports that all of the information should be getting gathered through those mechanisms, and that a supplemental report is at this time not necessary, but I think there may need to be in the short to medium term future something more defined for the OEC reports being submitted from the ECCs. Again, I'll get some clarification on that and send that back.
Teresa, I agree. That's a really good answer. That means less work. Does anybody want to create more reports and send them to OEC? Okay, Teresa, yeah, go ahead and make some more reports and just send them to OEC, and I'm sure they'll read them. Okay, any other questions? Should we do a countdown? Phil can probably find a countdown for us quick, but I can just say countdown while I'm waiting for, see if there's any other questions. Sarah, do you have any parting words?
No pressure. No, I don't, unfortunately.
Okay. Well, again, I like shorter meetings rather than longer meetings. And if we can end early, I always like that extra time. And I just got a reminder that I have to turn in my my pay sheet. So that will give me time to do that. Unless somebody else has a question, thank you all for coming. And enjoy your wonderful Friday. Yes, I recorded it, Teresa. So you can have Phil's words on record until he changes them. Thank you, Deanna, Carrie, Deb, Kristen. You rock too, Tina. TGIF, have a great weekend.